Welcome back again. I hope you feel already quite comfortable with navigation in Blender, selection, scaling and modifications. Because now we are going to jump right into our first real tutorial where we are going to load a PDB file into Blender. To do that, there are several different methods and I would like to go through all of them with you. The method of choice depends highly on what software is available to you, because we are going to use some supporting software to prepare the files that are going to be loaded later on into Blender. However, there is an internal add-on that you can use to load your PDB file, and we are going to activate that. In case you did the previous course, which is the 3D rendering for chemists, that add-on is already activated for you. If this is your first course, then just follow and we are going to activate that now. So you go into the edit section and enter the preference section. If you select the tab add-on, you are going to get a huge list of different add-ons, and to make it easier for us to find what we are looking for, we are going to use the search bar and just type PDP. And in your case, there's going to be one add-on that pops up, which is called Import-Export Atomic Blender PDB or XYZ. If you enlarge that tab, make sure to highlight or to select all three of the options over there. The second thing that pops up on my screen is something that we are going to talk about later on, so we can ignore that for now. I've just have it already installed, but I'm going to guide you through that step by step as well. If the add-on is activated, you can close that window again, and then we can start right away. The first thing that we are going to do is we are going to delete our default cube. So just select it, hit X, and then delete. Next, we are going to go to File, Import, and then we are going to select the Protein Data Bank section over there. Then you are going to be asked to locate your file. I already downloaded a file from the PDB. And in that case, in my case, it's an enzyme that I worked with during my PhD thesis. I chose that one because I know it the best and it's easier for me to do navigation for that enzyme. So select the PDB file as it is and hit import. What happens now is if you zoom out, you see that every atom of your protein is imported into that file, which looks like a huge mess. So it's not only the chain of the enzyme in that case, but it's also the water that is surrounding the enzyme. Of course, it depends if your PDB file has water surrounding the protein or not. So it might be that those things are missing. I know that my file actually has the water surrounding the protein structure. So that explains why there is a lot of oxygen present. That structure is really large. So you see, we are not even able to see our camera anymore. So it's somewhere buried inside that huge mass of atoms. But we can easily solve that. So go ahead, use the funnel icon over there and activate the selectable. And we are also going to activate the display in render section. And then we are going to lock the light and the camera by just clicking on it. That means you are not able to select the camera and the light again. So you cannot do that by accident. But we are able to select all the different types of atoms that are present in our scene now. And these are a lot. So you see what Blender does here is it creates a new subfile or a subfolder for every atom type that you can find. As I said before, if you already did a tutorial on how to load small molecules for the rendering for chemists, this looks very familiar to you because it looks exactly the same as you would find it for a smaller molecule. So I would like to make that a bit smaller now. So I'm going to select all the atoms by just hitting A and then hitting S for scale. And I'm going to scale it down. And suddenly you see there is our camera again. And if I hit 0 to go into the camera view, I can scale it down even further to make it fit the frame. As you can see and as you can guess already, that is not a depiction that is very functional, let's call it that way, because it's a huge mess of just atoms there. So there is not a high value of information present in that scene now. Somewhere in the middle there is my cofactor that is buried, but you cannot see anything. This is the downside of using the internal add-on from Blender, because you cannot choose how your protein is depicted. So you cannot go for a cartoon representation or a surface representation, which is really, to be honest, a bit sad. However, I'm going to make some more stylish version out of my protein with an emphasis on style rather than on function or content of or amount of information. What I'm going to do now is I'm just going to work with the carbon atoms, which are the gray one here, but I'm not going to delete the rest. It might be that we need them again, so I'm just going to keep them there, but I would like to hide them. So for the nitrogen, I'm going to click on the eye and you suddenly see all of the nitrogen atoms are gone, but they are still in the list. I'm also going to collapse all the atom types that I don't need. I'm going to do the same thing for oxygen, for sulfur, for phosphate, and now we are only left with the carbon atoms. Keep in mind that hiding those atom types does not mean that they don't show up in your rendered scene. For that, you also have to deselect the camera next to it. I'm also going to do that, just in case I would forget before I render. So suddenly you see it's only carbons here. Something in the middle, there are some bonds or connections that come from the cofactor, also a total mess, to be honest, but this is something we are going to ignore. And we are going to work with the carbon atoms now. The good thing is that under the Create tab that you can find here, there is a menu which is called Atomic Blender Utilities. And if you make that larger, there are a couple of different options that you can, or different modifications that you can do to your atom types. For example, you can make them bigger. So now it looks more like a space-filling version of it. You could also change the way they look. For example, change the shape to an, now it's just like a round ball. So you can change it to an icosphere, for example. To make the change visible, you need to hit replace. Now you see it's not smooth anymore. We can even choose an icosphere with a lower number. I need to select it again. So we can choose the icosphere 2, then it gets even lower. So that would be just playing with the style more or less. I'm going to stay with the standard settings, which was spheres. Select them, spheres, replace. The reason I show that to you, even though it's not really functional, is because for the first time we are going to learn a bit more about different shaders and different materials that we can assign to our objects. Until now we only worked with the cube, but now we will take a bit care about how our surroundings and how our objects actually look like. We are going to work with the render engine cycles again. So make sure that for all the tutorials you select cycles. Eevee is the standard render engine that is selected, but stick with cycles. So go into the render properties tab and select cycles. By hitting C, you can switch between different render modes. The solid is the standard one. The rendered would be the preview version of your final image. And this would be the scene now as it is. And to be honest, it already looks quite cool, if I might say so. So what we have present in our scene, if I go back to the solid mode, is the camera here, we have the light over there, and we have our protein over there. And the light basically is in charge of the shadows that we see here, and they look actually pretty cool. So let's play a bit with the color and the representation of those atoms. So go ahead and select them. And to change the color, for example, of the carbon atoms, click here to unfold the menu and select the latest option available, which is called Carbon Ball. And if you are entering the material menu here, the material properties, you see that there is already a color defined, which is this grayish, whitish color. But we would like to have more control over how the carbon atoms look, and therefore we are going to activate nodes. So just click on Use Nodes, and then a standard material is going to be assigned, which is the principled BSDF material. And the first option that you can change here is actually the color. And I'm going to change that now to a color which is probably not the best one to use for carbon, but just to show you what's going on. So I'm going to go for an orange. So now you see what happened is that our material or our atoms have some kind of reflection already visible. And by changing the values that you can find over here, the appearance of the atoms actually changes as well. It is a good idea to activate the preview because that gives you an idea how your final material is going to look like. Of course, you can stay in the rendered mode, but this is something sometimes quite harsh on your computer. So if you would like to have it more effective, you can also use the preview and stay in the solid mode and check what's happening to your material here. I'm going to give it a try and I'm going to stay in the rendered preview. The first thing that I would like to do is I would like to have my atoms a bit more glossy. So I'm going to turn down the roughness. And as soon as I do that, you see that the reflection areas over there are way smaller now. It's also visible in the preview. So you see that now it's very glossy. If you would like to have even more reflection in that material, you can also turn on the metallic value. So you see, if I turn that up, and if you pay attention to the preview over there, the floor suddenly starts to be reflected in the ball as well. In our case, you see that you suddenly see the reflection of the neighboring atoms, especially in the darker areas here as well. So you see that basically the atoms mirror themselves, which gives it a very cool effect actually. So playing with the metallic value over there is also something that is a good idea. I'm going to leave it up to you to play with all the other settings that you can find here, because I think that's actually quite a fun thing to do. And it's nice to discover what those values do. Just something that I would like to highlight, because it's not that obvious. If you would like to introduce some transparency, you can change the alpha value from 1 going down to a lower value. So you see that the lower the value is, the more transparent your material is going to be. And it looks actually really fuzzy here now. So you see that it's more like a nebula rather than a hard solid surface. Another thing that you can do is you can turn the emission on, but for that, it's a good idea to have a different material, and we're going to try to do that now. Instead of having a solid material, you can choose from different other predefined materials, and one of those materials is glass. If I switch to glass now, you also see that the representation here looks actually very weird, and in order for you to see a little bit better what's going on, we are going to introduce another object, which is going to be a plane. That can be done by going to Add, Mesh, Plane, or if you would like to have a faster way to do that, you can also hit Shift, A, and then the same menu pops up, and then you just select Plane. And then, in the middle of your scene, a plane appears. I would like to have it a bit larger, so I'm going to hit S and then move my mouse and scale it up. And suddenly you see that our protein in that case is actually cut in half. I'm going to leave it like that because it nicely shows what the glass shader actually does. In addition, you see that that the protein is now casting a shadow as well, something we have not seen before because it was basically hovering in space and there was nothing to catch the shadow. So the glass material now, if I zoom in, looks a bit like that. So I'm going to go select the carbon ball again to enter the material tab. Of course, you can do some changes to the glass material as well. So you can change the color, or you can change the refraction index. So this is set to something that should represent glass. But of course, you can go down to something that goes closer to the value that you would find for air, which would be the value 1. So 1 would be the value that has no refraction, and you also see that in the preview and also in your rendering. So if you go beyond that, your material gets a reflection-like shininess again, and if you go above 1, it's more like you would find for water or for glass. So this is also something you can play with. The default value is 1.45. I'm going to stay with that as well. Emission is also something that looks rather cool, and this is something we are going to add now. Oops, sorry. And that can be done in the volume menu. So if you enlarge that menu, by default there is nothing selected here, but you can go ahead and select emission, and that would cause your object to emit light. And by changing the value, the amount of emitted light can be larger and can be smaller. And if I zoom out again, you see what happened. So now your atoms are emitting light, and that is also visible if you look closely on the plane that we added here, that light is also emitted on the plane and also nicely visible in the shadow where there is this greenish area now. You can also change the color of the emitted light, so from, for example, in this case, from green or from white to blue. Of course, then you get a mixture of the color of your material and the light that is emitted now. Later on, I'm going to show you where that actually looks quite nicely, because to be honest, having a whole protein like this here emit light is often a bit problematic, because you lose even more information by doing that. So you see, it just looks like a huge blob of jello, and there is no detail visible anymore. But we are going to do a petri dish that contains agar, and this is actually a very nice method to create a material that looks like agar, because it should look like jelly in that case. Good. Another thing could be that you just decrease the amount of light surrounding your scene to make the object that has an emission stand out a bit more. So you can do that by just unselecting your light or hiding your light. So you see everything is a bit darker now. And you can go a step further by going into the world properties menu, where you can control how dark your world should be. By default, it is already quite dark, so it's the dark gray here, but you can go down to really black. And now you see that in that case, your protein would be the only light source that you have in your scene. And I can imagine that this is something that looks rather cool. For example, if you have something like green fluorescent protein or something, where you would have that feature of emitting light. In our case, as I said before, it looks like a huge blob. But in the next tutorial, I'm going to show you how to import your protein in a style like, for example, the cartoon representation or the surface representation. Of course, you could also rearrange the object a bit. So I'm going to move my plane down a bit so that the protein is just sitting on the plane, so that it's not cut in half. And if we go back into the rendered mode, you see that the plane is actually catching the light of the protein. And I'm also going to scale up the plane so that it covers our complete frame. So you see that it goes beyond the frame of the camera. For rendering our first frame, I'm going to go back to a more simpler scene. So I'm going to make the surrounding light go back to nearly the default gray. I'm going to activate the lamp again, and I'm also going to get rid of the emission of our material here. That can be done by re-entering the material properties, and you can go to emission again and say remove. Then that would be gone, so you are left with the glass material here again. And I'm also going to go back to the principled BSD material, the default one that we had before, stay with the glossy version of it, add a bit of the metallic shader so that we have a bit of the self-reflection of the atoms, and I'm going to change it to a nice light blue. And that would be the first scene that I would like to render. Before we render that, just a short remark about the lighting, because we did not talk about that yet. To change the way the light source is set, you can select light, and as soon as you do so, you see that there is a new menu popping up here, which is the light bulb. The default light source is a point, which would be something like a light bulb, and I like to change that actually to sun, because it gives you a more realistic representation. If you switch between light point and sun, the strength value is going to be kept the same, and the 1000 here is way too strong for a sun. Normally with something like 1 you are good to go, so it does not need to be that light, so it could be something between 1 or 5 depending on how light you would like to have it. Then the angle, the second value that you can change here, defines how sharp your shadow is going to be. The higher the value is, the softer the shadow is. So if you, for example, go down to a value of 1, you see that that shadow over there is very sharp. And of course, also the shadow that you find on the inside of the protein is then very sharp. I'm going to go for a sharp shadow here in that case. Of course, we would like to have a shadow. Sometimes that's not necessary. So if you untick it, then all shadows are gone. But of course, this is one of the strong points when you would like to use Blender, because then you get the 3D look by shadows. So I'm going to keep that. Multiple importance is just something that gives you a nicer quality of shadows. So I normally keep that ticked, and it's also ticked by default. Of course, you can also change the way or the position of your sun, and for showing you that, I'm going to leave the rendered view and go back into solid, because it's less harsh on my computer. So if you would like to change the way the light shines on your object, make it able to be modified again, so deselect the lock here, select the light, and then you see you can do a couple of things. The beam that actually goes to the point here and goes through our object is the angle that the sun basically shines on your object. And that can be changed. So if you just grab that one, you see you can move it. Having the sun pointing in that direction, for example, would be something that represents a very low standing sun, so something in the morning or in the evening. So if I release that, and if we go back into the camera view again, and if I go back into the rendered, you see that the shadow now goes very long into the distance. But that looks a bit weird, because it goes basically away from our camera. So it's always a good idea to have the shadow closer or on the left or the right side from your object. You can also define the way the shadow looks by not only just grabbing and moving the beam that is represented here with your mouse. You could also do that with the transformation menu over there, where you can change the location and the rotation. Changing the location of the sun is something that is not overly important. It is important if you have a point lamp, for example, but the rotation is very important. So let's, for example, set it down to 0. So that would be a sun how you would find it at noon. So it's directly above our object. And that looks actually really cool as well, because the shadow is directly underneath the object, and it's really a representation of the shape. But of course, you can also do a bit of rotation. So let's say we are going to add a bit of rotation on the y-axis to move the shadow a bit further away from our object. And then you see the shadow starts to go into that direction. And we can also do a bit of rotation on the z-axis to approximately move it back where it was before. And now the shadow is on that side. With that, I would say, let's try to render our first scene. I'm quite happy with the way that it looks like here. So I'm going to go into the render properties and I'm going to show you, or I'm going to explain to you some of the settings that you can find there. The little camera icon represents the render properties, and there are a couple of things that are important for you. I'm going to give you more tips on how to find the perfect settings depending on the scenes that we are going to do, because the settings depend on the style of your scene and it's very hard to explain everything without having the actual objects there. So keep in mind that the settings that I'm going to tell you are specifically for a scene, and the more you play with Blender, the more you get a feeling on what settings you need for which scene. The render tab over there gives you a number of samples. The higher that number is, the longer it's going to take for your image to be generated, but also the smoother it's going to look. Normally, if you have material that is not shiny and not reflective, you need a quite low number of samples. But since we have a material here that has a lot of reflection, we are going to stick with the standard amount here, which is the 128. The viewport sample number is the number that defines how your viewport preview actually looks like. So this would be the final image if you render with 32 samples. So let's give it a try with that one. We are not going to discuss those tabs. We are going to go back to them later on. The second thing that is important is the output properties, because that defines the size of your final image. That's the standard settings. I'm also going to keep those settings because they are the standard size of a frame or of a computer frame, which normally fits. Of course, you can adjust that to whatever you like and whatever you need. Then there is the output setting, where you can change the file format that you would like to have. By default, it's PNG. In that case, I'm going to switch it to JPEG. A PNG would be best if you have a transparent background, also something that I'm going to show you later on how to do that. But since we don't have that, a JPEG is good as well. Then that would be the color space, so you could choose to have grayscale or RGB. Of course, we would like to stay with color, so we are going to stay with RGB. And that would be the amount of compression, and 90 is fine as well. You don't need to give an output where your file is going to be saved, because that can be done after the rendering is done as well. Then I would like to show you a small trick on how to decrease the time your final image is going to take to be rendered. And this is something you can do by just going into the view layer properties and go down to the very bottom. And there is something which is called denoise. And denoise is basically just an additional calculation for your image that makes it look smoother with a lower number of samples. And this is also the reason why we can stay with 128 and not need to go any further. Having done all of these settings, you can go now to render and render image. And as soon as you click it, the new window is going to pop up and you see the tiles coming up with the final rendered parts of your image. Here you see the time, and also the denoise is done in parallel. So as soon as tiles are finished, they are going to be denoised. And you see that actually those tiles, I think, are already denoised. Those look a bit rough still, and they look actually very smooth with the amount of samples that we have. Depending on how well your computer is powered, the rendering takes longer or might be even shorter than mine in that case. So that might take a couple of minutes. I'm going to leave my computer rendering for now, and I'm going to come back to you as soon as the image is finished. So see you later. So this is now the final outcome of the scene, so the finished rendered scene. And I think it actually looks quite decent for the first scene that we did. So saving your final image now is also quite easy to do. You can just go to Image and then Save As. And then you have all the options that you've seen before also in our menu in Blender. So I'm going to go for a JPEG, as I said before, and then just navigate to the file where you would like to save your image and give it the appropriate name. Say save, and that's basically it. I hope that you're also satisfied with your first biomolecule in Blender. Take your time, play with all the settings a bit, and I'm going to see you in the next tutorial. Bye.